dreamed I was an Eskimo. Frozen wind began to blow. And my mama cried. And my mama cried.
Watch out where the huskies go, don't you eat that yellow snow. Watch out where the huskies go, don't you eat that yellow snow.
Well, right about that time, people, a fur trapper who was strictly from commercial had the unmitigated audacity to jump up from behind my igloo. And he started in the whipping on my favorite baby seal with a lead-filled snowshoe. That got me just about as evil as an Eskimo boy can be. So I bent down and I reached down and I scooped down and I gathered up a generous mitten full of the deadly
yellow snow.
The deadly yellow snow from right there where the huskies go. Whereupon I proceeded to take that mitten full of the deadly yellow snow crystals and rub it all into his beady little eyes with a vigorous circular motion hitherto unknown to the people in this area, but destined to take the place of the mud shark in your mythology. Here it goes now, the circular motion, rub it. Then, in a fit of anger, I pounced, and I pounced again. Great googly moogly! Well, he was very upset, as you can understand. And rightly so, because the deadly yellow snow crystals had deprived him of his sight. He stood up and he looked around and he said, he took a dog do snow cone and stuffed it in my right eye. He took a dog do snow cone and stuffed it in my other eye. And the husky wee wee, I mean the doggy wee wee, has blinded me. And I can't see temporarily. About that time, people, a fur trapper who was strictly from commercial had the unmitigated audacity to jump up from behind my igloo.
Peek-a-boo.
And he started in the whipping on my favorite baby seal with a lead-filled snowshoe. I said, with a lead-filled snowshoe.
Snowshoe.
He said, peek-a-boo.
Peek-a-boo.
With a lead-filled. With a lead-filled snowshoe.
Snowshoe.
He said, peek-a-boo.
Peek-a-boo.
He went right upside the head of my favorite baby seal. He went whap with a lead-filled snowshoe. And he hit him on the nose and he hit him on the fin. And he that got me just about as evil as an Eskimo boy can be. So I bent down and I reached down and I scooped down and I gathered up a generous mitten full of the deadly deadly yellow snow from right there where the huskies go. Whereupon I proceeded to take that mitten full of the deadly yellow snow crystals and rub it all into his beady little eyes with a vigorous circular motion hitherto unknown to the people in this area, but destined to take the place of the mud shark in your mythology. Here it goes now, the circular motion, rub it! And then in a fit of anger, I pounced again. Great googly moogly. I jumped up and down the chest of her. I injured the fur trapper. Well, he was very upset, as you can understand. And rightly so, because the deadly yellow snow crystals had deprived him of his sight. And he stood up and he looked around and he said, I can't see. I can't see. Doggy wee wee has blinded me, and I can't see temporarily. Well, the fur trapper stood there with his arms outstretched across the frozen white wasteland, trying to figure out what he's going to do about his deflicted eyes. And it was at that precise moment that he remembered an ancient Eskimo legend wherein it is written, whatever it is that they write it on up there, that if anything bad ever happens to your eyes as a result of some sort of conflict with anyone named Nanook, the only way you can get it fixed up is to go trudging across the tundra, mile after mile. Trudging across the tundra, right down to the parish of St. Alfonso. Yes, indeed, here we are at St. Alfonso's Pancake Breakfast, where I stole the margarine and wheedled on the bingo cards and blew a Vila tree. I saw a handsome parish lady make her entrance like a queen. Why, she was totally chenille and her old man was a marine. As she abused the sausage patty and said, why don't you treat me mean? St. Alfonso's Pancake Breakfast.
Wow, get off the bus.
Where I stole the margarine.
Oblivion, oblivion, resplendent in his rock, was whipping up batter for the pancakes of his pot. He was looking rather bleary, he forgot to watch the clock. It was the night before, behind the door, a leprechaun. The night before, behind the door, a leprechaun had stroked.
He stroked it.
The night before, behind the door, a leprechaun had stroked his
spot.
It sent him off in such a frenzy, he sang lock around the crop. And he topped it off with a, and he topped it off with a, and he topped it off with a. As he stumbled on his he was delighted as it stiffened and ripped right to his side.
Old Saint Alfonso would be proud of me.
He shouted down the block.
Ominous Vobiscum et Conspiratu 2-0. Won't you eat my sleazy pancakes just for saintly Alfonso? They're so light and fluffy white, we'll raise a fortune by tonight. They're so light and fluffy white, we'll raise a fortune by tonight. They're so light and fluffy brown, they're the finest in the town. They're so light and fluffy brown, they're the finest in the town.
Good morning, Your Highness.
Yes, indeed, here we are
at St. Alfonso's pancake breakfast,
where I stole the margarine and wheedled on the bingo cards in lieu of the latrine. I saw a handsome parish lady make her entrance like a queen. Why, she was totally chenille and her old man was a marine. As she abused the sausage patty and said, why don't you treat me mean? Alfonso's pancake breakfast.
Wow, God. Get off the bus.
Where I stole the margarine.
Behind the door, a leprechaun had stroked.
He stroked it.
The night before, behind the door, a leprechaun had stroked his spot.
Stroked his spot.
It set him off in such a frenzy, he sang lock around the crop. And he topped it off with a, and he topped it off with a, and he topped it off with a. As he stumbled on his he was delighted as it stiffened and ripped right to his side.
he shouted down the block.
Dominus vobiscum et conspiratu tuo. Won't you eat my sleazy pancakes just for saintly Alfonso? They're so light and fluffy white, we'll raise a fortune by tonight. They're so light and fluffy white, we'll raise a fortune by tonight. They're so light and fluffy brown, they're the finest in the town. They're so light and fluffy brown, they're the finest in the town.
Good morning, your highness.
Charge, I could reach Nirvana tonight. If I was ready, willing, and able to pay him his regular fee, he would drop all the rest of his pressing affairs and devote his attention to me. But I said, "Come here, brother. Who you jiving with that cosmic debris? Who you jiving with that cosmic debris? Don't you waste your time on me. Well, the mystery man got nervous and he fidgeted around a bit. He reached in the pocket of his mystery robe and he whipped out a shaving kit. Now I thought it was a razor and a can of foaming goo, but he told me right then when the top popped open there was nothing his box won't do. With the oil of Aphrodite and the dust of the Grand Wazoo, he said, "You might not believe this, little fella, but it'll cure your asthma too." And I said, "Okay, brother, who you jiving with that cosmic debris? Now what kind of a guru are you anyway? Don't you waste your time on me." I've got troubles of my own, I said, and you can't help me out. So take your meditations and your preparations and ram it up your snout. But I've got a crystal ball, he said, and he held it to the light. So I snatched it all away from him, and I showed him how to do it right. I wrapped the newspaper around my head so I looked like I was deep. I said some mumble jumbles then, and I told him he was going to sleep. I robbed his rings and pocket watch and everything else I found. I had that sucker hypnotized. He couldn't even make a sound. I proceeded to tell him his future then, as long as he was hanging around. I said, the price of meat has just gone up, and your old lady has just gone down. Well, yeah, brother. Who you jiving with that cosmic debris? Now, who you jiving? Don't you know you can make more money as a butcher? So don't you waste none of your time on me.
Of my resorts, you wouldn't think I'd have too many, since I never cared for sports, but I'm never really lonely in my eccentrical ports.
There's always Cola Plankton, him and me can play the blues. And then I'll watch him buff that tiny ruby that he used. He'll straighten up his turban and eject the little ooze along a one-celled Hammond organism underneath my shoe. And then I'll call
Pup Tentacle. I'll ask him how's his chin. I'll find out how the future is. Cause that's where he's been. His little feet got long and flexible, and suckers fell right in the time he crossed the line from later on the way back when.
We'll be right back. with a grindstone, they say.
Will that redeem us, Uncle Remus? I can't wait till my bro is full grown. I'll just throw away my do-rag at home. I'll take a drive to Beverly Hills just before dawn and knock the little jockeys off the rich people's lawn.
We have a song about feet. It's a foot song.
Feet,
yeah. The name of this song, ladies and gentlemen, is Stinkfoot. It goes something like this. Ready?
In the dark, where all the fevers grow. Under the water,
yeah.
Where the sharp bubbles blow. In the morning, by your radio, do the walls close in the suffocation?
Yeah.
Ain't got no friends, and all the others that hate you. There's a life you've been leading, gotta go.
Well, let me straighten you out about a place I know. Get your shoes and socks on, people. It's right around the corner, over by Tom Waits Restaurant.
Out through the night and the whispering breezes, to the place where they keep the imaginary diseases. Out through the night and the whispering breezes, to the place where they keep the imaginary diseases.
Ladies and gentlemen, scientists call this disease bromidrosis. But us regular folks who might wear tennis shoes or an occasional python boot know this exquisite little inconvenience by the name of, now watch this,
Stinkfoot.
Yes, indeed.
You know, my python boot was too tight. Couldn't get it off last night. A week went by, now it's July. I finally got it off, and my girlfriend cried. She said, Stinkfoot. Stinkfoot, dog. Your stinkfoot puts the hurts on my nose. Stinkfoot, stinkfoot, I ain't lying. Can you rinse it off, do you suppose?
Here Fido, bring the slippers, little puppy. That's a good dog. Arf, arf, arf.
Sick.
We'll be right back. that. Dreamed I was an Eskimo. Frozen wind began to blow. And my mama cried. And my mama cried.
Watch out where the huskies go, don't you eat that yellow snow. Watch out where the huskies go, don't you eat that yellow snow.
Well, right about that time, people, a fur trapper who was strictly from commercial had the unmitigated audacity to jump up from behind my igloo.
Peek-a-boo.
And he started in the whipping on my favorite baby seal with a lead-filled snowshoe. That got me just about as evil as an Eskimo boy can be. So I bent down and I reached down and I scooped down and I gathered up a generous mitten full of the deadly
yellow snow.
The deadly yellow snow from right there where the huskies go. Whereupon I proceeded to take that mitten full of the deadly yellow snow crystals and rub it all into his beady little eyes with a vigorous circular motion hitherto unknown to the people in this area, but destined to take the place of the mud shark in your mythology. Here it goes now, the circular motion, rub it. Then, in a fit of anger, I pounced, and I pounced again. Great googly moogly. Well, he was very upset, as you can understand. And rightly so, because the deadly yellow snow crystals had deprived him of his sight. He stood up and he looked around and he said, stuffed it in my right eye. He took a dog do snow cone and stuffed it in my other eye. And the husky wee wee, the doggy wee wee has blinded me. And I can't see temporarily. About that time, people, a fur trapper who was strictly from commercial had the unmitigated audacity to jump up from behind my igloo.
Peek-a-boo.
And he started in the whipping on my favorite baby seal with a lead-filled snowshoe. I said, with a lead-filled snowshoe.
Snowshoe.
He said, peek-a-boo.
Peek-a-boo.
With a lead-filled. With a lead-filled snowshoe.
Snowshoe.
He said, peek-a-boo.
Peek-a-boo.
He went right upside the head of my favorite baby seal. He went whap with a lead-filled snowshoe and he hit him on the nose and he hit him on the fin and he
that got me just about as evil as an Eskimo boy can be. So I bent down and I reached down and I scooped down and I gathered up a generous mitten full of the deadly
yellow snow.
The deadly yellow snow from right there where the huskies go. Whereupon I proceeded to take that mitten full of the deadly yellow snow crystals and rub it all into his beady little eyes with a vigorous circular motion hitherto unknown to the people in this area, but destined to take the place of the mud shark in your mythology. Here it goes now, the circular motion, rub it! And then in a fit of anger, I pounced again. Great googly moogly. I jumped up and down the chest of a... I injured the fur trapper. Well, he was very upset, as you can understand. And rightly so, because the deadly yellow snow crystals had deprived him of his sight. And he stood up and he looked around and he said, I can't see. I can't see. Doggy wee wee has blinded me, and I can't see temporarily. Well, the fur trapper stood there with his arms outstretched across the frozen white wasteland, trying to figure out what he's going to do about his deflicted eyes. And it was at that precise moment that he remembered an ancient Eskimo legend wherein it is written, on whatever it is that they write it on up there, that if anything bad ever happens to your eyes as a result of some sort of conflict with anyone named Nanook, the only way you can get it fixed up is to go trudging across the tundra, mile after mile. Trudging across the tundra. Right down to the parish of St. Alfonso.